We had a story at InfoWars a week or so ago about a new study that showed that GMO soy accumulates cancerous formaldehyde. Now, we're going to talk to the man behind that study. He is what many people call polymath. That is somebody who is an expert in widely diverse fields. Think about Thomas Jefferson, for example. He was all over everything. Well, Dr. Shiva Ayyadurai is one of those types of people. He has 4 degrees from MIT. He's a world-renowned systems scientist. He's an inventor. He's an entrepreneur. As a 14-year-old, he invented email. And Hillary Clinton wishes that he never existed at this point, I think. He gave her enough technical rope to hang herself publicly, and email has played a big part in her life. It's played a big part in our lives as well. It's a great invention, and he's the guy who invented it. Now, he's really, his core focus has been as a biologist, and he has developed a system, Cytosolve. He's a chairman and CEO of Cytosolve, Inc., and he does modeling of biological systems, and that has allowed him to, that's the basis of this study. So we're going to talk to him about these things, but there is a common thread. He is somebody who supports liberty, and he is somebody who understands the danger of the military-industrial complex. So we were warned about that by President Eisenhower, and we have seen that come true, and he talks about it in the same way that Eisenhower originally was going to talk about it, as the military-industrial academic complex, and that's the way that Dr. Ayyadurai talks about it, because it truly does roll together academia in a very vital way into this whole aspect. But we got a lot of topics to start with. Let's thank you for joining us, Dr. Ayyadurai. Let's start with the email. Tell us how, as a 14-year-old, you came about to develop email. And, of course, there was just a recent lawsuit. We keep seeing Gawker Media turn up in these lawsuits on the losing side, and they just lost a lawsuit with you. So tell us about your invention, and tell us about the lawsuit with Gawker over this.
Yeah, thank you. Great introduction, by the way.
Thank you.
So I think the point is, you know, email, I think the heart of it was not invented by the military-industrial complex. It didn't come out of the elite triangle of MIT or Silicon Valley or big industry. The fact is, you know, I invented as a 14-year-old kid in Newark, New Jersey, at a small medical college. And what I was fundamentally doing was solving a civilian problem. If you remember in those days, in many organizations, there was a thing called the inter-office mail system. It was how all organizations collaborated. At the heart of this inter-office mail system was a secretary. On her desktop was the inbox, outbox, folders. Underneath her desk was a trash can. On top of her desk was the address book. She would write a thing called a memo, and had a very specific structure, to, from, subject. She would make carbon copies. Business essentially got done through the inter-office mail system. It wasn't simple exchange of text messages. So as a 14-year-old kid, I was one of those very overachieving kids. I was also good at, believe it or not, in sports. But I went off to NYU because I finished my math courses by the time I was a 14-year-old kid, calculus, and I was accepted into a special math program at NYU in the Quorin Institute of Mathematical Sciences. In fact, in a special computer science program where I learned 7 programming languages. After I finished that, my parents were afraid of me dropping out, and I got a job at a small medical college called the University of Medicine Dentistry in Newark. And I was given this task of converting that entire inter-office mail system, and I put the word on system into the electronic computer-based version, and I called that email, a term never used before in the English language. But not only that, I converted all those 100 features in 50,000 lines of code across a system of 35 programs, and it was used. It was successful. We charged for it. Hundreds of people used it in that entire university. And more importantly, what was interesting was at that time, the policymakers in Washington didn't understand software. It was only in 1994 could you even patent software. But in 1980, the Copyright Act of 1976 was amended so you could use copyright to protect software invention. So as a young 18-year-old kid when I was at MIT, I sent away for the copyright, and it was not a trivial process. Mm-hmm. You had to fill in a ton of paperwork, and I was issued the first U.S. copyright for email, again, the only way to protect software. So I was officially recognized as the inventor of email. So not only did I create this electronic version of this entire system, called it email, but I also got the copyright. So the facts were essentially black and white. And I never sought, you know, a penny for it, nor did I seek any type of fame for it.
Let me interrupt you a second and say that's a very interesting thing, because now what we're seeing in technology with the copyrights, we're seeing very abusive use of the copyright system, where we have people say they file these junk patents and say, well, I got an idea that you could put pictures on a cell phone. And then they'll hold up Apple and they'll hold up Samsung and all these companies and say, pay me royalties for this type of thing. You never sought to capitalize on that at all in that way.
Exactly. So, between that period, 1980 to 1994, you could only use copyright, and only in 1994 did the Federal Court of Appeals allow the use of patents for protecting software. Mm-hmm. Now, we have to understand the whole notion of copyright or patents was originally done for independent inventors to protect themselves for a shortened period of time, and then it was publicly accessible. What's happened with the patent trolls is they've actually abused the patent system. Now, what's unfortunate about that is the big guys, Apple, Google, et cetera, have taken advantage of the patent trolls to say that we should completely eliminate patents, which means they want to make it trade secret, which would let the big guys essentially control all types of innovation.
Exactly.
And my belief is, when we go back to the heart of what the founding fathers wanted, what the heart of freedom essentially was in innovation, was that independent inventors should be incented to innovate, like that 14-year-old kid I was in Newark. Mm-hmm. And there's many people like that. You know, in fact, it was a 14-year-old kid who invented TV, took him 60 years to eventually get recognition for that, who was Philo Farnsworth. But I think at the heart of this and the spirit of this was, you have certain amount of protection to support independent innovation. And what's really happened is that much of the large entities have abused this, patent trolls, you know, and there's whole public entities, public corporations, which run patent trolls right now.
Sure.
But yeah. I think at the heart of it was innovation was really supported to support the spirit of creativity in this country, which was at the heart of why America is great.
And that's the key with everything. There has to be a balance. You know, we do exactly want to protect intellectual property, but then, of course, there's the patent trolls. But you didn't come at this as a patent troll. You came at this because you wanted to protect your reputation, and because also, as you pointed out, it's always the military-industrial complex that is trying to take credit for everything. And so you had this lawsuit that just recently got settled, $750,000 lawsuit you won with Gawker Media. Tell us about that.
Yeah, so here was the deal. You know, I went off to MIT after 81, 82, when I invented emails, you know, between 78 to 81. Went to MIT, did a bunch of degrees, had a very prolific career, started many companies, made millions of dollars in other inventions. In 2011, when my mom was dying of a horrible disease called pulmonary fibrosis, in a suitcase, she'd left all of this material and gave it to me. And Doug Ameth, who was a technology editor at the time, looked at all of this, and then he wrote an article called The Man Who Invented Email in Time magazine. After that, in February 16, 2012, the Smithsonian invited me and accepted all my materials. It was a big honor. The day it went into the Smithsonian, you know, which should have been an occasion for celebration, in fact, of what America is truly about, what you see is you see this backlash from the academic elitist historians and the cabal of the military-industrial complex, who in those 35 years, when I hadn't really promoted myself or rewritten the history, that a defense contractor called Raytheon, and they had essentially created a false narrative that email came out of the military. What they had done was simple text messaging. In fact, we found a document clearly showing that they had no interest to, in fact, invent email because they thought it was impossible. And so as you're showing, Raytheon had essentially created this huge branding. So when my stuff went into the Smithsonian, it was like a new, you know, skull being found in Africa, which completely changed the origin of humans. So they had to destroy it. So you see the fake news sites like Gizmodo, Gawker, start calling me all sorts of names, horrible names, trying to destroy my reputation, all my 4 degrees at MIT, everything I'd done. So, you know, in Boston, for example, I wasn't able to find any law firm to take this on because many of them had links to Raytheon.
Wow.
When Hulk Hogan, the beginning of this year, won, which was, in a jury trial, a great case that Charles Harder represented, I called up Charles, and Charles took on my case. 30 days after I filed, Gawker claimed bankruptcy. And the irony, sort of the karma of this whole thing, was that I get appointed to be one of the co-chairs of all the unsecured creditors. So it was a big victory for us because the facts were so obvious. Gawker clearly didn't want to go to the jury trial. And frankly, I never cared about the money anyway. You know, for me, it was one principle, my reputation, to call someone a fraud, a liar, and a fake when I was being 100% truthful is absolutely ridiculous.
You know, when I hear this, what this reminds me of, Dr. Ayyadurai, is the struggle between Langley and the Wright brothers. And you know, you're talking about how they wanted to take credit for this. And of course, the big airfield is named Langley Air Force Base, not Wright Brothers Air Force Base. Langley didn't make any progress in terms of creating an airplane because he was using the charts and the observations that people had recorded that were incorrect. The Wright brothers looked at it and they said, wait a minute, let's go back to square one. Let's do our own measurements. They came up with a system that worked. He never got anything to fly, and yet the government named the Air Force Base after him because he was president of the Smithsonian. He was connected within the government, but you got a couple of homeschooled bicycle builders who were the ones who actually made the first working plane, not the guy who was affiliated with the big military industrial complex of his day.
Yeah, and I think in my case, you know, I'm not saying that someone would not have created email,
right?
You know,
right.
Because the march of office automation and computing was coming together, but I was the first to do it. I created the entire system, got it working. In fact, we billed for it, people paid for it. The military was doing these little dinky text messages.
Yeah.
In fact, this guy within the military, Ray Tomlinson, all he did was a 15-minute job to be able to attach text to a remote file. Raytheon has conflated that, the at symbol, to equal email. In fact, they made $240 million in 2014 based on this reputation.
Wow. Hang on. We're going to talk about that more, but we're also going to talk about what you have to say about GMO. We've been talking about the fact that he was the developer of email, the original inventor of email. He was credited as such. And once he was credited, that got the establishment, especially the military industrial establishment, very upset. They pushed back against him. They assassinated his character, and not in an effort to be some kind of a patent troll, but simply to defend his reputation, to defend his honor. He sued Gawker, the parent company of the publications that came after him, and he prevailed in that. But we're also going to talk to him about his research on GMO. He is a man who is an expert in widely different fields, and the field that he is stayed in, for the most part, the field that he got his PhD in is biology and biological engineering at MIT. So we're going to talk to him about what he's found in GMO. And of course, going back to this article again, there was a previous study. Researchers in Egypt found that with GM soy, genetically modified soy, they had DNA fragmentation increased significantly. They had glyphosate tolerant enzymes were found in the blood. And this toxicity increased at 30, 60, and 90-day levels as they fed rats this genetically modified soy. They also found the kidneys' biopathology increased. They found chromosomal aberrations in these rats that they were feeding genetically modified soy. See, it matters what you put in your body. It's very important. And we're not saying that soy is bad, but there's a different form of soy that is harmful, as we see in the study, and as he's going to talk to us in the research that he did. Dr. Ayyadurai, before we get to genetically modified soy and your research on that, I want to finish up a little bit more on this email. As we're going to break, you were talking about the profit motivation that the military-industrial complex was getting by claiming that they had invented email. There was a profit motive in it as they were coming after your reputation, wasn't there?
Definitely. I mean, if you look at it, you know, Raytheon, around 2009, you know, post 9/11, the large defense contractors, many of them got involved in the cybersecurity business. It was a lucrative business. Today, it's around a $70 billion industry. Raytheon, around 2009, bought a company called BBNN, which was really in the acoustic business, and they rebranded themselves as the inventors of email. In fact, 7 days after I went to the Smithsonian, they actually created a website, or not they, but their surrogates, called the Internet Hall of Fame, and they award Ray Tomlinson the inventor of email award. The timing is not coincidental. But the reality was this $70 billion cybersecurity market was very lucrative. All the major defense contractors started the cybersecurity division, including Raytheon, and they rebranded themselves. If you look at their website that you showed up, you know, they've since taken that down after we exposed this. The at logo is almost like the Nike swoosh. They brand themselves as innovators and they have their mascot. So when my stuff went to the Smithsonian, it basically was exposing their marketing myth. It's almost like they'll imagine exposing that Michael Jordan didn't shoot all of his baskets, that Ray Tomlinson didn't invent email. So that was really the economic motivation to attempt to destroy my reputation. And they use their surrogates in the academic historian community. In fact, when I gave my work to the Smithsonian, the agreement was they would display it for all young people in the United States to get inspired. To this day, the Smithsonian has not displayed my artifacts. In fact, the end of 2015, I met with the new secretary of the Smithsonian, David Skorton. And within 30 minutes of looking at the facts, he said, Shiva, you need to get an investigative journalist. He wrote to the head of the National Museum of American History, John Gray, and he basically, to his own boss, he basically said, we have no intention of displaying this. So this is a level of collusion that goes on in academia. Academia is not doing the work that it was meant to do. It does really the work of large corporations who funds them. So this notion, I think you've been discussing on the show, if you look at the East Coast elitist academics, the Hollywood people, these people have this liberal ethos, but they're fundamentally fascistic in many ways. And fundamentally,
hang on, we're gonna continue with that, and we're gonna talk about how they use their position of authority to control our information. We're gonna come back with Dr. Ayyadurai, and we're gonna talk about the biology aspect as well. And as you heard at the beginning of that clip there, you heard President Eisenhower saying, in the councils of government, we must guard against the acquisition of unwarranted influence, whether sought or unsought, by the military-industrial complex. But of course, he was also talking about universities. A couple of paragraphs down, he says, today, the solitary inventor, and that's who we were talking to, Dr. Ayyadurai, the solitary inventor, tinkering in his shop, has been overshadowed by task forces of scientists and laboratories and testing fields, and in the same fashion, the free university, historically, the fountainhead of free ideas and scientific discovery, has experienced a revolution in the conduct of research. Partly because of the huge costs involved, a government contract becomes virtually a substitute for intellectual curiosity. For every old blackboard, there are now hundreds of new electronic computers. He said the prospect of domination by the nation's scholars, by federal employment, project allocations, the power of money is ever present and gravely to be regarded. And so that is the fundamental thing. First, you see the solitary inventor like Dr. Ayyadurai. They come against him. As it had already been established, he was the inventor of email for monetary purposes, but also to establish their authority. Because argumentation from authority is the key way that they control the narrative. And so this is an issue not only about his invention, but it's also an issue about the military-industrial complex. And I want to talk about his next invention here now, which is his cytosolve system. And, of course, he is a biological engineer. He has a PhD in systems biology with the MIT Department of Biological Engineering. He has 4 degrees. He is proficient in a wide variety of different issues. I want to talk to him about the GMO aspect. We've mentioned this and teased this earlier in the show. But one of the things that he sent to me was he said that in 2014, he saw in the MIT Technology Review a story titled Buy Fresh, Buy GMO. And that got him thinking. Talk to us, Dr. Ayyadurai, about the essence of GMO. I think a lot of people really don't understand the difference between transgenic, genetically modified things and things that are just selectively bred, you know, because we've had massive genetic variation between, let's say, dog breeds, okay? Just look at dogs as one example. And that was done by selective breeding. That's something that's been done for thousands of years. But what we're talking about now is something that is fundamentally different. Transgenic can allow them to combine plants with animals. It can allow them to provide to combine chemicals with plants or animals. It's very, very different. Tell us about this article, Buy Fresh, Buy GMO, and how that alerted you to the dangers that were being sold to us by academia.
Yeah, I think great observation, by the way, David. So, you know, when I saw that article, Buy Fresh, Buy GMO, you have to understand between 2003 and 2007, I went back to MIT to do my PhD to really create this new technology called cytosol, which would help us really model very complex molecular pathways using the computer. So in 2014, when I saw that, frankly, it was an ad. This is MIT's Technology Review, and it was an ad for GMOs. And as you read through that article, what you find is that there's this false narrative being created that the developing nations, for example, like Africa, India, we all must have GMOs, because without GMOs, there's no way we're going to be able to produce enough food to feed the masses of the world. Right. This is sort of this narrative that goes on. By the way, you know, Henry Kissinger pointed out that if you really want to control people, it's not through oil, but control their soil.
Yes.
So MIT is a part of this, you know, voice was really essentially advertising GMOs. And so I said, you know, why don't we use cytosol, which we had published, which we had gotten all sorts of great feedback from all the major publications, to really understand at the molecular systems level what's going on. Now, to the audience out there, to your point, David, it's a very important point. A GMO is where they take a gene from, let's say, from a fish, which has a certain property. Maybe it can withstand cold because of its skin, and they transfer it, let's say, to like a tomato. So this is not something that occurs in nature. Many of the mainstream publications, New York Times, et cetera, were essentially supporting fake news by these, basically these bogus scientists who were trying to convince all of us, oh, don't worry, genetic engineering or GMOs is no different than plant breeding or normal breeding that takes place in nature. In normal breeding, you have a full, you know, interaction of all the DNA, not just one little gene. So this is sort of the big lie that got promoted. Don't worry, you know, genetic GMOs are no different than full-blown breeding. But the reality is, what occurs with a GMO by taking a gene from one species and putting it into another in a test tube doesn't occur in nature. So that's what a GMO is. That's what they call it, genetically engineered foods or GMOs. So what we said was, why don't we really do a deep dive, use cytosol, this very powerful technology, by the way, which we've used to create new medicines, which has been published in Nature and Cell and cited there. Why don't we use this to understand what is going on? So what we did was we said, there had been some reports by some farmers in the Midwest saying that they had seen higher levels of formaldehyde in GMO corn. No one was able to understand the mechanism, so the traditional, conventional academic sort of poo-pooed it. So what we did was we said, why would that occur? So it turns out in all plants, all fungi, and all bacteria, there's a core molecular system called C1 metabolism. To keep it simple, plants, for example, take sunlight and they put together carbon to, you know, create what's called carbon metabolism. That C1 metabolism pathway, we went through nearly 11,000 papers across 6,000 research results. Using cytosol, we were able to combine all that and extract that, and we found the major molecular pathways of C1. That was published in paper one. Very, humbly, we published that.
And let's add here briefly, this is peer-reviewed. So these are peer-reviewed papers that have come through here. That's very important for the scientists to understand that.
And open access. Mm-hmm. You see, the old model of publishing has been a little old boys network, where in the major journals like Nature, in fact, Randy Shechtman, who won the Nobel Prize, he's come out against the big journals saying it's an internal cabal of who gets to publish. So, but we went to open access journals, which is you have peer review, but it goes directly to the masses and you don't have to pay a fee to download. So we published that first paper.
Let me add one other thing too, because that also parallels what we've seen with the internet and with news. You know, one of the ways that you can control the narrative, and we saw this when there were only a few networks out there, just you're talking about, we had a parallel structure in the peer reviewed journals. You've just got a few publishers. And what they choose to report and what they choose not to report can be a form of censorship. And so you were able to transcend that by going open source, going directly to the public, but still having it be peer reviewed.
Yeah, in fact, you know, the story, for example, Einstein never published any papers peer reviewed. He thought the whole concept of peer review was ridiculous because if you're an innovator publishing something new, how can a peer even review that? He felt that it should go direct and let people make the decisions.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
In fact, when one of his last papers, they said they wanted a peer review, and he said, give it back to me. So this whole notion of peer review has been created in some ways by the priesthood to control knowledge.
Exactly.
And they brand it as though they're the only ones who can decide for us who should read what.
So, I agree. You know, and that's why I put that out there, because we have that priesthood every time we'll talk about something. Well, was that peer reviewed or was that not peer reviewed? And it's like, okay, exactly. in this situation, they were peer reviewed. So there you go. So let's move forward
exactly.
with that.
Yeah. I mean, I've published in peer reviewed. I have, you know, those credentials. But the reality is this whole assumption is based on the average person is stupid and we're going to tell you what you should even read.
Yes.
But that's it. Yeah. You know, it's a bigger discussion. But anyway, we published the first paper. The second paper, we literally took these molecular pathways that we've discovered from the literature, which people had done in experiments, and we converted them to mathematical models using cytosol, and we interconnected them. That was papers 2 and 3, and we showed there was, in the normal condition for all plants, that they normally, process carbon by a pathway where they do create formaldehyde. It's called a methionine and methylation pathway, but then they detoxify it. So in the normal case, all plants do create a little bit of formaldehyde, but they detoxify it. However, what we found was under certain stressful conditions, pollution, or when there's a drought, a plant will actually deplete its glutathione. I noticed in your commercial, you talked about selenium. Selenium is an amazing mineral, which actually helps, it's a precursor to glutathione. Glutathione is a very important antioxidant, which helps break down formaldehyde. So what we found is in normal plants do create formaldehyde. They have enough glutathione to make sure formaldehyde is detoxified. However, under stressful conditions, the glutathione gets depleted and formaldehyde accumulates. So those were papers 2 and 3. In the fourth paper, what we did was we looked at GMO soy. I think the point you made is important. Not all soy is equal. 97% of the soy in the United States is genetically engineered. Monsanto created a version of GMO soy called Roundup Ready Soy. It's a version of soy which can withstand their own pesticide called glyphosate or Roundup. Mm-hmm. So when you plant one of their seed can also withstand their own pesticide. That's called Roundup Ready Soy. What we found out in Roundup Ready Soy, by the way, the way they created Roundup Ready Soy was they took a gene from a different bacterium and they shoved it into the soy seed, in the normal soy seed. And that let it create another immune system to withstand their own Roundup. So anyway, what we found was when they inserted that new gene, it actually perturbs the entire C1 metabolic system and puts the plant into what's called oxidative stress. The plant actually thinks it's under stress. It depletes its glutathione and formaldehyde accumulates. That was paper number 4. When we published this, we were attacked by the pro-Monsanto surrogates, including a guy called Kevin Folta, who was the head of agriculture, the head of the Horticultural Institute of the University of Florida, part of the priesthood. He said, by the way, this guy didn't create email. And furthermore, his research is just a model. And he also said, I have nothing to do with Monsanto. As some of your viewers may know, subsequent to saying that, a FOIA was issued on him by a nonprofit group in the West Coast. 4,000 emails came out with a clear email from Monsanto to him, giving him $25,000 to be their spokesman.
So there you go. You got him with your own invention, email.
Exactly.
So 4,000 emails between him and Monsanto showing that there was a connection besides the $25,000 that they gave him. So
So Folt has been exposed. And so it's funny, the irony is the email is a tool that was used to expose him. Now, more recently, the end of last year, we published a fifth paper because people like the Folters were saying, oh, this is just a mathematical model. We went back in and we actually did focus on glutathione, and we were able to show that glutathione levels are nearly 300% less in the GMO soy. Not only that, we found research that was done 3 years ago, 4 years ago in 2011, but a little bit longer than that, in Leeds and duplicated in Leeds by researchers who had actually grown the GMO and non-GMO soy in the greenhouse, and they too had found in the actual live plant 300% less glutathione. So what we're saying is we've been sort of told, oh, these plants are much more resistant to drought, et cetera, but it's actually completely false. What we're finding is that the GMO soy has 300% less glutathione. Let me tell you, glutathione is one of the most important antioxidants for cleaning up, detoxifying our body. So if the soy has 1/3 less, you can imagine what that means to the nutrient value. Mm-hmm. It gets even more interesting. Glutathione, our view is because it's less than the soy, even the soy's immune system is lowered. That's why many of the GMO seeds, they're coating them with a thing called neonicotinoids, which is a coating which protects the seed from soil organisms. So what you're seeing is the entire process of creating GMOs is completely screwing around with nature. So not only do they have created an organism which is less stronger, and then they have to coat it with another pesticide.
It's kind of like the laws that the government does. They create a problem that makes us more vulnerable, and then what they do is they double down with that with more laws that make us even further vulnerable. And I think it's interesting when we look at Monsanto, you're talking about how they start to go down this path. Where you began on all this, you said they're selling us GMOs, saying that's the only way that we can feed the population of the planet. And yet it's Monsanto that creates these seeds that you have to keep buying from them because they won't self-replicate. So they're actually creating a situation that would hinder our food supply for their own profits, aren't they?
Exactly. I mean, this entire process, you know, is a very insidious process.
Yeah.
And the biggest so-called respectable people from the Gates Foundation, the big academics, are all behind this, right? So, you know, you go to a place like Africa and India, you show bloated babies, and then you convince everyone they need, you know, help from, it's a neo-missionary attitude. So we've gone into these developing nations, destroyed their soil, giving them sort of unidimensional types of crops, wheat and corn. And many of these countries had their own biodiversity. And then we forced them to buy GMO seeds because that's a new market for Monsanto. Mm-hmm. And as a part of that, we're selling the GMO seeds as well as the pesticides. And that's really at the crux of why there's a lot of these issues in public health in all of these countries, including our health. In fact, 2 days ago, a paper just came out in Nature showing that low levels of glyphosate Roundup cause, you know, fatty liver. You know, e.g. obesity, et cetera. This just came out in Nature. So at the foundation of all of this, when you go back to where I grew up in India, my grandmother was a traditional farmer, a healer. Traditional systems of health and nutrition were really based on using our food supply, natural systems, natural herbs to support us. And what we've done is, through the military-industrial complex, Monsanto and Dow, for example, as you may know, they're the ones who created Agent Orange, which was to defoliate Vietnam. They took that entire infrastructure and reused it for delivery of Roundup and glyphosate on factory farms. So the military-industrial complex and their industries thrive on reusing the technologies they created for war in their secondary markets back in civilian life. That's why something like the invention of email, as you're showing the slide, perturbs this entire narrative, because the narrative is the golden triangle of the military-industrial complex is where all great innovation comes from.
That's right.
And they should all bow down to that.
And that's why they wanted to discredit you. Stay with us. We're going to be right back with Dr. Ayyadurai. I want to go back to what we've been talking about. And, of course, as you point out, we talk about glyphosate and Monsanto. They genetically engineer and they created these problems with the accumulation of formaldehyde because they've created soy that is not going to be affected by their glyphosate, okay, which is a weed killer. But when they spray this indiscriminately, then this can go over and kill people. Even if people are trying to do something that is organic, their plants are susceptible to this because they haven't been genetically modified. They're susceptible to being killed by this. So we've seen this kind of damage that has been spread by this. And of course, I'm sure you're aware of what's going on in India. Farmers become indebted to Monsanto because they start buying a GMO seed, and then that seed does not reproduce. They turn into debtors. They've had massive numbers of suicides in India. Speak to some of that for us.
Yeah, I mean, I think you're bringing up some very good points, David. It's an insidious cycle, right? So
yes.
What they've done with the GMO seeds is they've made it into almost like a software licensing model, right? Mm-hmm. So if you and I are both farmers, let's say you're next door to me and you're not using Monsanto's GMO soy, and I am, let's say, for example, one of my seeds happens to fly over onto your property, Monsanto will unleash their legal apparatus to force you to now license their seeds.
Yeah.
And in fact, you can be, you know, litigated against and in fact suffer massive fines. In India, what's happened, you know, with these, you know, in India, a small farmer may have many kids. His entire livelihood is based on farming his plot of land. So in countries like India, many of these GMO producers have essentially experimented with GMO seeds. Some of them work, some of them, quote unquote, work, some of them don't. And these farmers become indebted to them. And the licensing model, as you said, is every year annual, you have to come up with more money.
You mentioned something as we're going to break. And that was how Monsanto was going to essentially a software licensing model, where people would have to continually re-up and continue to buy their seeds every year. And we've seen this even from car manufacturers, truck manufacturers. I remember reporting on this about a year or so ago. Under the Digital Millennial Copyright Act, they said, we own the software that runs your car. So you farmers who are used to working on your trucks, you can't do that anymore. We own that. And you can't modify that or even work on it in your own way. Of course, now they're going further down the road. They're coming out with the autonomous self-driving cars, which are not even interested in saying that they're nominally going to sell to you. They're turning everything into a renting model. They want to make renters out of all of us. We've seen this with the International Monetary Fund. And this is what they have been doing for a long time. This is the model that they want. They want everyone to become their serfs, to become their renters. And nowhere is this more clear than in the way Monsanto has used these seeds against farmers in India. Continue on with what you were saying about the software licensing model. That's very important for people to understand.
It on the head, David. It's a sharecropper model, right? Mm-hmm. You basically want to make people become essentially slaves. And it's a model that's essentially anti-American because in many ways it's monopolistic at its deep, deep core that basically forces people where they're essentially selling their land, whether they know it or not, in an indirect but direct way to organizations like Monsanto. And this is, again, I get back to that point when Kissinger said, if you want to control nations, you don't need to control oil, but control the soil. And that is fundamentally what these organizations are doing. And at the heart of it, if you go back to the core of this, you know, you have, you know, so-called intellectual liberal elites like Hillary Clinton, Barack Obama, who has allowed people like, for example, Michael Taylor, who is a former head of science policy at Monsanto, to be appointed deputy director at the FDA, where they have put in together policies which has allowed the Monsantos of the world to essentially control this entire process. And yet these same people, what the irony of it is, these same people have the gall to promote themselves as liberal intellectuals who care for all of us. And I'm so disgusted by this because for me, having been at MIT in and out of there for 33 years, you know, I'm sort of an insider in some sense. And like Donald Trump says, how he knows how Wall Street operates, I know how academia operates. It's all about control. Many of these academics really do not even care about profit. They care about controlling narratives. So in this model, the narrative to control, as we saw in that MIT article, is that everyone must need GMOs. So they create that narrative, which perpetuates into organizations like Monsanto, essentially feeds their marketing engine.
Yeah, and that's the whole essence, is the fact that they hide this, that it is very dark, very subtle. They hide this information just the way they hide it from the farmers. These farmers didn't know they were going to get hooked into a sharecropper model with Monsanto. They ultimately wind up in massive numbers committing suicide when they find out how bad it's become. And they had the dark act, where they said, we're tired of fighting these battles that are developing at the local and state level where people want to know what's in their food. They want to know if it's GMO, and they don't even want that to happen. And they take it to the federal level to say, we're going to shut down all local and state laws. We're going to hide this from people. That's the essence. If we can shine the light on it, that's the key.
Exactly. And what's interesting, what you said with the Dark Act, is some of the so-called liberal elites of the organic movement actually sold out the non-GMO movement. They actually collaborated with the politicians and lobbyists in Washington to make the non-GMO, the GMO labeling so difficult for ordinary people by making it a QR code where you needed a smartphone. Well, not every average American has a smartphone. Mm-hmm. So over and over and over again, you see this hypocrisy of the liberal academics claiming they care for minorities and ordinary people when in fact, their entire process is actually subvert the entire process of truth and science and to essentially promote these very, very false narratives and fake news, be it on email or be it on GMOs, or as we're seeing right now, I know you guys have covered it on the Russian hacking.
They thrive on the misinformation. They thrive on hiding it. Thank you so much, Dr. Ayyadurai. And sure. I think it is amazing, the irony, as you point out, that the guy who tried to destroy you was exposed by email, which you invented, and we now know that. Thank you so much for joining us.